I think we're all here. Wonderful. So welcome everyone to the SSP Wednesday seminar. I'm Taylor Fravel, the director of the Security Studies Program. And it's my great pleasure today to introduce our speaker, Lorenz Lüthi, who is an associate professor at McGill University in Montreal and a leading historian of the Cold War. His first book, The Sino-Soviet Split, Cold War in the Communist World, won the 2008 Furness Award and the 2010 our Marshall Shulman Book Prize. And I'll add that for those members of the graduate program here at SSP who have taken my Chinese foreign policy graduate seminar or who will take it in the spring, you'll have the great pleasure of reading Lorenz's book. It's an absolutely superb account of one of the fascinating periods of the Cold War. His other publications have covered the Vietnam War, Asian and African internationalism, non-alignment as well. But today he's going to talk about his new book, which is a svelte 750 pages, Lorenz, is that right? Which is basically sort of Cold Wars in other regions of the world, Asia, the Middle East, and so forth. And so it's a really great pleasure to have Lorenz here today, not just because of his new book, but also because he's someone that I've known in the broader China field going back to 2002 for the graduate students in SSP. Lorenz and I first met at the New Faces conference that's put on at the Triangle Institute in sort of Duke and UNC area, which brings together political scientists and historians. And in our case, it's spawned a very productive friendship. And so all of these things that you do now, the reason why I raise this as graduate students, will sort of pay off and sort of stick with you for the rest of your career. So with that introduction, Lorenz, I wanted to turn the virtual screen over to you. Thanks so much for coming today.
Well, thank you. Thank you for the very kind introduction. And thank you to you, Jolie and Andrew, for inviting me. And thank you for having me at MIT, at least digitally. So welcome to everybody. Hello from Montreal. Well, it's nice to talk about my book finally. I held the first copy, hard copy of it in my hands on March 12th. And then on March 13th, the lockdown in Canada started. So great timing. I had to cancel a book tour through Europe and then nobody read my book for understandable reasons. It was an odd situation, but well, that's life. We are living in difficult times, and not talking about my book might be one of the very small sacrifices I have to make. I'm alive and well, and this is what matters, and I hope you are in the same situation. So still, let's talk about the book. I titled it Cold Wars, Asia, the Middle East, and Europe. And you might have noticed a couple of oddities in this title, Cold Wars, it's a plural. And Asia precedes the Middle East and Europe. So if you have done so, you have actually picked actually some of the issues I want to discuss. And I want to make in the book, and I want also to provoke discussion. So we just had a little chat beforehand, said, you know, if you prove me wrong, you only your work, that's great. But then at least we talked about my book, right? So I have no problem if you contradict me and if you show me that I'm wrong. But I hope I was right, more or less. But let me really start from the very beginning about this book. We all believe that we know what the Cold War is or was. And my question is, do we really do? I grew up in Cold War West Europe in Switzerland in the 1970s and the 80s. And I thought that the Cold War was a solid American competition over Europe. This is why I actually studied the Cold War, why I decided to become a historian. I eventually studied history at the undergraduate and graduate level in Switzerland, Russia, China, Germany, and the United States between 1990 and 2003. And I got my PhD thinking I knew what the Cold War was. Or did I really know? As I moved to Canada and I started to teach at a Canadian university to a student body from six different continents, i.e. from all continents except Antarctica, I increasingly became uncomfortable about the Eurocentric interpretation of the Cold War. For example, the vast majority of people who died in the global Cold War were not Europeans or Americans. Just think about Korea, Vietnam, or the larger Middle East. I talk about general interpretations of the Cold War, not about individual case studies. So around 15 years ago, I was finishing my previous book, which Trailer has just mentioned, and I started to have really some intellectual discomfort, let's call it. And then I decided actually to track down the reasons why I felt so uncomfortable with the way we look at the Cold War. And this is always a good sign, you know, if you actually feel uncomfortable about something, about the interpretation, maybe that's a sign that you have to rewrite, you know, that part of the field. The more I was looking at American decision-making based on the National Security Council files in the Foreign Relations of the United States volumes or on Soviet decision-making, and you can look at the CPSU Presidium files, you know, from the Khrushchev period, you know, the more I got the impression that the superpowers really weren't in charge. That when you read these documents, the impression you have is that they're continuously reacting to one crisis after another that is actually thrown at them. So, but if it's really true that they're reacting and not really acting, who then causes the crisis? Who then is in fact in charge of you know, creating the Cold War? Now, that was sort of the guiding question I had. I was interested in who is shaping, who is driving actually the Cold War. Now, at this point, when I talk about my book project, I usually bring in the chess metaphor. Imagine the Cold War was a chess game with the superpowers as the two chess players. All agency rests with them. None of the lifeless chess figures which represent the other states in the world, you know, basically have any agency. This is how many interpretations of the Cold War, global interpretations, see actually the Cold War. You can start with my own advisor, John Lewis Gaddis, and then there's Melvin Leffler and all the others. It's really the two superpowers, and they sort of pull the strings, and they make the puppets dance. Now, just imagine that these chess figures also have some agency. For the sake of the argument, they're little animals with a will of their own. As soon as one of the superpowers has put them down on one square, they start to scroll and walk off that square. The chess players then need to build dams with their hands to prevent them from proceeding or use a finger and push that little animal down on the square. But of course they run out of hands and fingers. And occasionally they use a swat, you know, a fly swat to strike at one that walks off actually that chessboard. This is how the Cold War looks like. That's really, in my view, the description actually of the Cold War. It's a good metaphor. There are two chess players, the two superpowers, and there are 32 chess pieces which are doing what they want, albeit, you know, with a very small range of opportunities and, of course, capabilities. So there's a difference in power, but there is definitely power also on the chessboard. Let's continue with the metaphor. Let's imagine that these chess pieces have friendships with each other, or, you know, they're enemies with each other. They fight each other, build alliances, and decide to mediate when neighboring chess pieces start to fight. All this happens in parallel, 32 chess pieces and two chess players, interacting with each other in all kinds of combinations over time and changing combinations as well. Some of them might have old fights that date back to another chess game played before by two other chess players, right, to another historical period. Others have new ones. So now you suddenly see, you know, we talk really about a very complex international system, which most political scientists in theory would acknowledge exists, right? But, you know, when we write Cold War history, all that complexity goes out of the window. And again, I talk about global Cold War history. I'm not talking about individual case studies that actually acknowledge that this complexity exists. I talk about global interpretations, which are extremely reductionist because they only focus on actually two chess players. The problem here is now when I started to think about the book, how to write it, is that I had to know now an awful lot about an awful lot of individual chess pieces. And the problem is not that you can describe them as a group, right? Because their behavior is individualized. When you look at, a flock of 1 million sparlings or a school of 1 million herrings, you know, you describe the behavior of one and then you can actually describe the behavior of all the others because they have sort of common behavior and that forms the also group behavior, right? But that's not possible in a system of states. You have to know actually quite a lot about the individual states because even if political scientists like to actually generalize, you still talk about a relatively small number of very individual states. So how do we write the history actually with multiple agents? That was the next problem I had to approach in this book, because it's really about multiple agents, about returning agency to middle and smaller powers, still acknowledging that the superpowers exist and that they matter, right? I will come back to them in a moment. At this point, when I was thinking about how's the structure of a book, remember when you write a book, or some of you might be actually still writing a dissertation, you write a unidirectional story. You have a discrete start, you walk your readers through an argument to a discrete ending, right? This is how books actually are constructed. It's a convention which we all actually subscribe to. But that's not really possible if you have multiple agents. So you have to rethink the structure of the book. And sort of the eureka moment came when at that point in time, you know, my great love in my life, you know, intellectual love, which is opera, you know, comes in. And this is, I was sitting actually in an opera in Berlin. It was Die Walküre by Richard Wagner. And I suddenly realized that Richard Wagner had actually solved the problem I was facing. Remember this the Ring der Nibelung, this cycle of four operas, is in fact a huge network of narratives. It's not one continuous narrative. There are narratives that start somewhere, interact, and then fork off and disappear. And there are continuous narratives that are parallelly interact all the time and certain points, right? So I realized that he's actually, you know, doing exactly what I want to do. Of course, he has other means to do that. He has music. He has this idea of the memory motifs, of the light motifs, of the guiding motifs, where you can hear in the music makes references to other stories, right? I cannot do that. I cannot print in different colored ink and so on. So I had to rethink actually that too. But ultimately, you know, he gave me some ideas. So the second idea here is, you know, think about, you know, a network as a fishing net, you know, that is lying, you know, spread out in the sun, you know, on a wharf in a harbor, right? And you're standing on one side of that net, representing 1917, and you look to the other side, which is representing 1991. And you can now pick any thread on your side and try to follow that thread. And you will cross at several points through nodes where other threads, you know, basically, you know, tied up with that thread in order to create the net. And at every single node, you can decide or not, you can decide where you want to go. Of course, this metaphor is familiar to you. This is, you know, how theorists would talk about path dependency, right? But ultimately, this is how I wanted to tell actually a story. I wanted this path dependent, you know, on previous threads. You can pick any thread on your side and do that story. What you do essentially decide what the narrative is, right? Where you go at every single point, right? And you can restart this over and over again. So my book is a collection of various narratives, parallel narratives, where I always start at one side of the net and follow in a thread I just picked up, you know, and I'm interested in how do they interact with other threads. So, and this is where then the structure of the books comes in, how I started to think about this book. As you now realize, to a certain degree, I have already thrown out the superpowers to a certain degree as the main storytellers or the main, you know, agents. And I also removed to a certain degree the Cold War as a paradigmatic idea that drives the 20th century, or at least the second half of the 20th century. What I want to do now is to basically stress the point that there are other paradigms, there are other narratives that matter too. And one is a very important one, that's decolonization. Decolonization is always acknowledged as being there and playing a role in the Cold War, but it's a major story of the 20th century. It starts well before World War I. It continues throughout the interwar period, and it goes way into the 60s and 70s. And it's not only decolonization, it's also a story about actually nation and state formation. Not only in Asia and the Middle East, but even in places like Europe. Think about Poland, think about the two Germanies. And it's essentially this focus, what I do in the book is I start to a certain degree with decolonization as a paradigm and how this is then, you know, replaced by the Cold War as a paradigm or over time. But this then forces me to think about decolonization more systematically. And this is why Asia and the Middle East precede Europe in this book. And this is why the subtitle is Asia, the Middle East, and Europe. So I try to turn the Eurocentric narrative, which is so so prevalent in my field and to a certain degree also in poli-sci, on its head and say, wait a minute, we have to put Europe last in this story. Now, what are the general findings I have? You know, that was one finding already. So a general finding is that small and middle powers substantially changed the nature of the Cold War over time. The Cold War looked radically different when you compare the late 40s with the late 70s, and I say now late 70s by choice, there's a reason why I say that. And much of that change was not necessarily, you know, caused by the superpowers. It was caused by multiple choices and decisions made at the lower and at the middle level of the Cold War system. So in fact, what is happening, and this is why I say the late 70s, what is happening by the late 70s, early 80s, is that the regional incarnations of the global Cold War are in fact vanishing, particularly in Asia and the Middle East. And in Asia, I'm not the first one to make that argument. I just stretch this argument now to the Middle East and also to a certain degree to Europe. At least by the late 70s and early 80s, the structures that allowed the Cold War to end by the late 1980s in Europe were in fact already in place. And then, you know, the interesting question is not why did the Cold War in Europe suddenly end in 1989? The question is why did it take so long, the whole 1980s, to end? That's the question we then have to answer. So another finding is that regional developments also influenced each other. You will see from the structure of the book, I have sort of discrete regional and thematic blocks. And of course, some of these stories, China, Vietnam, India, are very much tied to each other. That's why there are these groups of three. But then, you know, these clusters of stories, the seven parts of three stories each, you know, they are also tied to each other. So there are connections at different levels. There are regional connections, but there are also trans-regional connections or inter-regional, international connections. So usually my argument is that influence actually flows from east to west in a sort of clockwise direction around the periphery of the socialist world. So Asia to the Middle East and Asia and Middle East to Europe. And this also then means that it makes perfect sense to really start this story, you know, not only in Asia because of decolonization, but because influence does flow into that direction. Just think about the Korean War, 1950. It's a regional war. North Korea did not plan to make this into a global crisis, but it has this really huge global impact. It has an impact on China, it has an impact on Vietnam, it has an impact on South Asia, on the Middle East and Europe, on Germany. NATO, the NATO militarization is a direct response to the Korean War. So it becomes this larger, this really large event that certainly wasn't planned by Kim Il-sung. He just wanted to take over South Korea and thought, well, that's it, right? And finally, we have a revolution in all of Korea. Occasionally, however, it goes also the other direction. You know, it would be unfair just to say this is a unidirectional move. Hungary, you know, the uprising in Hungary had a major influence on how Mao actually thinks about, you know, the problems in China and, you know, really reads then into the Great Leap Forward. The Afghanistan War, 1978-79, is another case, had a major impact actually on China and to a certain degree on Vietnam as well. And of course, it had an impact on the Middle East and on Europe. So, you know, again, you have to acknowledge that it goes also the other way. Now, finally, I think we also have to move away from this idea of bipolarity. I don't use the word bipolarity or tripolarity or polarity at all in the book, except in the introduction and actually in the sort of the legacy chapter. I think it's a misnomer. It sort of implies that there are two magnets and then by some invisible force, all countries, you know, sort of either move to direct themselves to one or the other side. It's just not the case. First of all, there were not two great powers in 1945. There were three. We forget that. The United Kingdom, There were three great powers that won the World War II. And, you know, to say that Great Britain might be a little bit less powerful than the other two, well, that's debatable. But there was no number four, there was no number five, there was no number six, no number seven, no number eight. And there might be somewhere Canada. And France, that was just being rehabilitated. China was nowhere to be seen. Japan and Germany didn't matter, and large parts of Europe were destroyed. So the three powers, they might have had different economic and political and military leverage. I grant this, but there were three powers in their own class, and there's no doubt about that in my mind, the big three. And they still actually cooperated way into the 50s. The last actually point of cooperation is 1963, the negotiations to the limited to nuclear test ban treaty. That's the last time where the Soviet Union and the United States acknowledge Great Britain as an equal. And then the slide really continues. The slide already starts after 56, in fact. So we have to really think about, you know, how do we reintegrate Great Britain into this story, and then, you know, see how it drops out of that great power race. I use the term superpower only by the 1960s. This is where the Soviet Union and the United States really become superpowers in a class of their own, largely on the basis of nuclear weapons. But at its very time, as they become superpowers, their power, as they become elevated in the hierarchy, their power at the very bottom starts to really frizzle out. Think about the United States and Vietnam. The United States had the largest number of nuclear warheads in the late 60s and early 1970s, and it still lost the war in Vietnam. Military power does not mean that you have political influence. Same thing with the Soviet Union, had the largest number of nuclear missiles, not warheads, in the 1980s, and it still lost the war in Afghanistan. So we have to account for that, right? So that means we still have to explain what is going on at the lower levels of the structure. So let me talk just about one example, why I think it's important sort of to relegate the superpowers to maybe to a background, to the background, just for the purpose of research. And then when you write, you sort of put them back into the story. We know so much more about both of them than we know about many other of the smaller powers. But, you know, let's put them outside of the discussion and then reintegrate them the way I did it in the book. Right? I want to talk about October 1956. There were three crises. In October 1956, in mid-October, the Polish October started. Then on October 23rd, on October 23rd, the Hungarian uprising. And then on, of course, October 29th, the Israeli intervention at the Suez. And then, you know, on the October 30th, the Franco-British sort of, political and then military intervention as well. Now, most historians see, write, teach about these three classes, if they mention them, you know, which they often don't. But if they do, they mention them actually in individual units. So they're not teaching them actually as one crisis, as a triple crisis. And they mention that they write about them in the context of, you know, Suez and the United States, you know, the famous Diane B. Kunz book, you know, the economic diplomacy, how the Americans forced the British and the French out by economic means, or in the context of the Aswan Dam, or, you know, Hungary in the context of the Soviet Union. But they are in fact connected. And I try to do this in the book to a certain degree. Now, let me just talk about this. Now, the Suez Crisis was kicked off by the Egyptian recognition of the People's Republic of China in May 1956. And the reason is that Egypt wanted to break through a self-imposed Western arms embargo on the Middle East. And the only place they could get weapons at that very time, or so they thought, in Cairo, is actually from China, because the United Nations was considering an arms embargo, a global arms embargo on the Middle East, and China was not a member. So this was a preemptive step by Nasser to keep open a channel of weapons in the hope actually to basically match what they saw at that time as Israeli superiority, military superiority. Now, this led to the well-known American refusal to basically fund the Aswan Dam, which then actually led to a Soviet offer to do it, and eventually to the Egyptian nationalization of the Suez Canal Company, not the canal. The canal was always Egyptian. It was the canal company, which had huge assets and which had a steady stream of income, which Nasser wanted to use actually to fund the Aswan Dam. And this then leads to all kinds of attempts and to mediate, and eventually Israel, Great Britain and France decide to intervene. Now you see, China is already part of the story, but usually not acknowledged to be a part of the story. China really then recedes into the background. There's other stuff going on. I just talked with Taylor about that. I mean, there's a Sino-Burmese border conflict that almost explodes in September 1956. Doesn't really. But China is again a story, in late October, when the Soviet Union invites actually a Chinese delegation to Moscow to discuss the Polish October. And eventually, that's exactly the time when the Hungarian Revolution actually explodes. So they discuss at that time Poland, Hungary, and Suez as something that they see is, in fact, that something that belongs together. And they have Khrushchev on record in October 30th seeing these things connected in one larger crisis. He says, we have to send troops back into Hungary to suppress the revolution, because this is an imperialist ploy. This is a ploy by the French, the British, and the Americans. And if we don't do that, they will add Hungary to Egypt. Of course, he sees Khrushchev and the Chinese see what is happening in Egypt as an American, English, British ploy. And of course, it's not, the Americans are not in there. They try to get the British and the French out. And they see this as counterproductive. And in the wake of this story, John Lai travels for 3 months through Asia and East Europe to try to mediate in all kinds of conflicts, right? In the Kashmir conflict, in the sign of, he appeals to India to help to mediate in the Sino-Burmese border conflict. He goes to Poland to help the Polish work out the differences with the Soviets. He goes to Hungary. However, he doesn't manage to go to Egypt because Nasser ultimately doesn't trust him. Trust the Chinese communists. So if you now use this really wide lens and trying to capture what is actually going on, what are all these narratives? How do they intersect with each other? How do they change structure on the ground? You suddenly see that the superpower impact, particularly in the case of the Soviet Union in Egypt, is probably minor. The Americans had greater impact largely because they could use economic leverage to get the Americans and French out. Now I could go on this example. I could talk about Pakistan, India, Yugoslavia, and Poland and what they did and so on. It's really, there's so much to tell about this story and it's not being told. But let me now return to the title of the book, Cold Wars. Why would I call it Cold Wars? Here again, I want to redirect our focus. There is a global Cold War. There's a hierarchy of Cold Wars, a global one, there are regional ones and there are national ones. And this global Cold War first rages between the big three and then the two superpowers. And then there are these other Cold Wars, and some of them are directly sparked by the global Cold War. Germany is a good example. The division of Germany is a Cold War conflict, right? Others are subsumed by the Cold War. Vietnam is a conflict. The Indochina War after 1946 is a war of decolonization that becomes a Cold War conflict. South Asia, the Kashmir conflict, Pakistan, India, this is a local conflict coming out of decolonization, gets subsumed into the Cold War through alliance building. But others, in other cases, the Cold War is manipulated by local actors, like in the Middle East. And in a Sino-Indian border war, in that case, simply a spin-off conflict where the superpowers are not really involved. So we really talk about the multitude of Cold Wars that have very different characteristics. Now, if I have still not convinced you, and I know we are running almost out of time and we'll shut up in a moment. So I give you a counterfactual question. How would the Cold War, the global Cold War, have looked like if somebody like Gorbachev had been Stalin's successor in 1953? instead of Khrushchev or Brezhnev, pick any of the other readers. I have asked this particular question, many of my colleagues, and I was surprised how uniform the answers were. If you conclude, like most of them, that the course of the Cold War would have been not significantly different, or that the Cold War would have not ended earlier, and it would have not ended in a peaceful manner in the 1950s or 60s, then you essentially agree with the points I just made. You essentially agree that the structural context in which the superpowers act, you know, really matters, and that we really have to focus on that structural context to explain the Cold War. That doesn't mean we don't have to focus on the superpowers, right? It's not an either or choice, but we need to focus on structure and how this structure was formed over time. And that means we have to really systematically integrate what these smaller powers on the chessboard actually did. Well, that's all what I have prepared for today. So thank you for your attention. And I'm sure I have now a ton of questions.
Wonderful. thank you so much, Lorenz. So the floor is open. Please raise your hand using the raise hand function or send a note in the chat, and I will be sure to view it there. Let me start while people are organizing their thoughts. That was really interesting. And I want to take you, I guess, outside of the book a little bit and ask you about the current situation. So everyone talks about there being a US-China Cold War, or that we're at the start of a US-China Cold War. And whether or not that's the right analogy or metaphor, clearly, like, we're going to be in a US-China competition with global dimensions. And so what should we be, like, based upon your sort of this really detailed history of the original Cold War or the Cold War, what lessons would one learn for how this US-China kind of competition might unfold? What were sort of the things that sort of you came across in this book that you think okay. What might be relevant to how the world is now changing?
Taylor, I have to chide you. This is a very unfair question because you basically go directly to the sore point, right? The sore point is, you know, the term Cold War. I mean, of course, I have Cold War in the title. I realized I cannot take it out, and I wanted to play on it, Cold Wars, to sort of, you know, have people start thinking about it. But the reality is this one, that Cold War as a term is a Eurocentric term in by itself. It was actually shaped by George Orwell. It's really about the British perspective of, you know, conflict, the absence of hot war in Europe. There was an awful lot of hot war in the rest of the world, and I just mentioned that most of the dying actually happened outside of Europe. So the question is really, can we talk about the Cold War when you talk about, you know, very strictly speaking, you know, in the narrow sense of the term, can we talk about the Cold War in the rest of the world? And, you know, Kovel Meissner has just made the argument that there was never really a Cold War in China, right? I think he really points into the right direction. The word Cold War wasn't really used by Mao. It was increasingly used by the Soviets, but mostly in relations to actually, you know, to the United States over Europe. So this was an adaptation in the Soviet Union. So this is a Western term that, you know, as terminology doesn't really work in the socialist world, definitely not in China. So, there's very little in terms of conceptual thinking that we could use, you know, on Mao's China side, you know, that would point to a Cold War between China and the United States. So I would throw this out, you know, for the past. Now, can we use the term Cold War, you know, for what is happening now? I also think, and there's absence of hot conflict, okay. But, you know, if any great power conflict in the past, you know, is called a Cold War because there's no hot war, then sort of the term becomes meaningless, right? So we have to ask ourselves, what is the Cold War historically? And is this, you know, there's the ideological conflict. In the case of China, we could talk maybe about the Sino-Soviet split as a Cold War. I used it, the title of my book was Cold War in the Communist World, my first book. I did this strategically so that in Amazon.com people would find it. we can't really talk about, we might be able to talk about the Cold War and the end of a Cold War and then sort of a conflict. But then, you know, we have the problem of domestic politics because a lot of that sinusoid split is very closely tied to more managing domestic politics. That sort of isn't really the case either now. There is, you know, the nuclear dimension that isn't there in Sino-American relations. So I think mostly the reason why I talk about a Sino-American Cold War, or Cold War 2.0, or whatever you want to call it, is because it's a catchy phrase. It attracts attention to anybody who uses it, and, you know, we have the attention of the public. It gives us maybe a starting point to discuss what is going on, but I think we should not overstretch using that particular term.
If I could just follow up, how do you think, though, smaller or middle powers today, right, will be those agents that you talked about at the beginning, right, these other chess pieces?
Yeah.
Right. If the US and China are going to be the largest world powers, and I sort of agree with you on the coal, I don't want to stretch that too far, but if they're the two players, using your chess metaphor, right, what would you sort of be watching now, or what do you think is sort of most underappreciated in terms of how kind of the US-China competition will unfold and the way in which that it might actually be driven less by the US and China, or perhaps be driven more in ways that we don't yet appreciate by kind of smaller and middle powers?
Yeah. Let me maybe just go back to this to the South American competition, and I didn't really talk about that for time reasons. One conclusion I draw in this book is also that usually the Americans intervene in other countries and other countries' affairs more often than the Soviets. But the Soviets, when they intervene more deeply. And that's one of the key, I think, why the United States was ultimately so successful, that, you know, it engages, but it leaves partners enough wiggle room. It gives agency. It is particularly successful when it co-opts existing developments. And it's particularly successful in actually co-opting and nudging them here or there. And it's European integration, West European integration is a particular good example, right? It co-opts actually on ideas that are already there. It gives some political support, some advice, but essentially lets the West European do that by themselves. So it is actually engaging. It is in continuous search of allies. I'm not telling, and it's not saying that all these allies are really savory characters. They aren't, right? But it's very good at being flexible, at basically exploiting opportunities. And China tried to do this lately a little bit, and it's really backfiring on China, what we see now, because it's always, you know, sort of, you know, it's a nice glove, and then you have the iron fist in it, you know, with economic interests and whatever. I mean, Sri Lanka is a good case, Africa are cases where, you know, it alienates actually the partners. I think, and, you know, I'm not going to say anything now about domestic politics in the United States, but you know what the implication is. I think the United States has to go back to what it was particularly good at in the 50s and 60s, at fostering relationships and encouraging actually, you know, partners to do certain things. So if we truly believe that this is a Cold War, and if we truly believe this is a Cold War between actually the liberal West, and liberal now in its old meaning, not in the one, the distorted meaning now from the American political discourse. And we believe that we have a future, and we believe that the Chinese system with its authoritarianism is not the future. We have to stand together. We have to redefine what we stand for and how we do this collectively. And I don't think so that the United States has to take the leadership role all the time, the way it did it in the 50s and 60s, because it was much more powerful in relative terms then than it is now. But, you know, there has to be a kind of a sense to, you know, we have to look beyond just our borders, and we have actually common interests, and we have to defend them jointly.
Great, thank you. Steve and Ever, you put a question in the chat. Do you want to turn on your video and ask your question? You there, Steve?
Oops.
Oh, there you are.
There I am. Am I visible?
Yes.
Yeah. My question departs somewhat from your talk, but I'm just wondering for your basic framework, the way you analyzed the globalization of the Cold War. Do you think it was a mistake or a smart chess move? There's sort of two views. One is that the Cold War never should have been globalized. If you think the way Kennan did, the Cold War was about preventing the Soviet Union from taking over industrially important areas that would allow it to develop a war machine that could project power across the Atlantic and threaten the US, which meant that the Cold War should have been confined to Western Europe and Japan, and should have been confined to limiting Soviet expansion, but not indigenous communist forces in the developing world. And people like Kennan regretted the globalization of the Cold War and viewed it as a blunder. Wondering what you think about that. What's your view on it? And if you think that it was a mistake, why do you think that mistake got made?
Okay, you know, I'm totally with you and with Kennan on this one, right? And this is why I picked out the Korean War in 1950 is for me really an important year. There's a first chapter in this book. This is from actually high imperialism to a divided world. And I look 1917 to 57, that's sort of the time frame. And that sets the stage for the book because I have to explain the structure. That's the starting point, right? I completely agree with you. I mean, and I agree with Kennan. I think Kennan got his threat perception of the Soviet Union right. Yes, there's an ideological, actually, long-term goal in the Stalinist Soviet Union, but Stalin is extremely cautious. And you basically have to deny resources to this country, i.e. West Europe, mostly West Germany and Japan. And if you deprive it of important resources, the weight of its cumbersome economic system will actually lead to its collapse relatively quickly. And that's exactly what happened, right? And he also says somewhere you shouldn't actually resort to military force because military force or military solutions will force the Soviet Union to become more competitive and reform internally. In fact, he was right on this one too. So I found he's very visionary looking back. He really got it right on so many levels. To a certain degree, there is a misreading on the American side. Ken has at a certain point, 47, 48, really an influence on thinking. And then, his influence is already waning. There's an overreading of Soviet capabilities, of Soviet intentions. And of course, once the Soviets get nuclear weapons in August 1949, and then the Chinese Revolution happens and the establishment of the People's Republic, there's really panic in Washington. And this is where the departure, you call it mistake. I'm sort of hesitant to talk about mistakes. But this happens plus the Sino-Soviet Friendship Treaty and then the Korean War, and this all is perceived as, in Washington as a larger part of an ongoing Soviet offensive, right? A worldwide offensive. And this is the reaction then. This is where the alliance building, the alliance formation happens. This happens, already starts a little bit before in Europe, but this is where militarization starts of NATO. You have SEADO comes, the hub and spoke alliance system in East Asia, CENTO, right? You sort of try to now build dams, right? You have it in Europe, you have it in the Middle East, you do it also ultimately after 54 of the Geneva Conference in Southeast Asia, and you have, various individual actually alliance systems in East Asia. And the whole thing is this, you wall in the socialist camp, right? And it's exactly this walling in that then creates a lot of reactions. I mean, Nero reacts to it, Nasser, a lot of the problems in the Middle East, they already exist, get exacerbated by this alliance system. It's an overreading on the American side of Soviet intentions. And I completely agree with you. If 49, 50, 51 hadn't happened, the Cold War would have stayed European and maybe a Japanese event, maybe Korea, and here and there some places. But the globalization of the Cold War really happens with the Korean War. And this is an American, actually, globalization. And then the Soviets catch up, starting with Khrushchev by 54, 55. A long answer to a short question.
Great, thanks, Lorenz. Next, Heather Williams. Heather, if you can turn on your videos on, turn on your microphone. Thank you.
Yeah. Hello. That was really fascinating. I wanted to pull the thread on one idea that you had in terms of what it means, not just for competition, but also for cooperation. And so when you said how we have to move away from this idea of bipolarity, and we can't just keep thinking of them as these magnets, there's a lot of implications for that, actually. So, you know, one of them being the US and the Soviet Union, they weren't magnets always at odds with each other. There were occasions when they did cooperate and when they did work together. And so that I think that imagery is actually really helpful to think of moving away from. And so I'm wondering, can you kind of maybe talk a little bit about, to use the chess analogy, were there occasions where the superpowers actually cooperated to try to gather up all of those chess pieces that were going rogue? And were there cases where the chess pieces, when they were going rogue, they actually cooperated with each other? And I realize this might just be complicating it, and maybe I'm taking the analogy too far, but I really wanted to hear a bit more about what it means in terms of cooperation.
No, it's great that you actually pick up on the idea of the thread, right, and the chess pieces. And I understand, you know, these analogies sort of don't always work. First of all, there's a lot of collaboration between the two superpowers during the Cold War. We forget there's a peace conference, 46-47, if I remember correctly. And this is peace conference on the smaller, actually, enemies in Europe, right? And they come to an agreement. They come to an agreement on Romania and Bulgaria and Italy and you name it, right, and Finland. Then there's cooperation with the recognition of Israel, right? There's cooperation at the United Nations on a whole range of issues, on health issues. When you read these documents, I haven't done it, but friends of mine have done it, you wouldn't think that there's a Cold War, you know, there's an exchange about, you know, vaccines and whatever, right? I mean, it continues. 56, ultimately, you know, the Soviet Union and the United States are on the same side in Suez, and they implicitly cooperate. And they cooperate very much in the Security Council, right, by creating UNIF. It's the seminal peacekeeping force that is actually now created. So and so on, right, this collaboration on nuclear matters after the Cuban Missile Crisis, they have a community of interests, like preventing nuclear war, right, and, you know, cementing their duality, actually. I call it a duopoly at the expense of everybody else, right. So there's numerous cases. Where are there cases where they tried to gather, you know, all the chess pieces and basically lead? I think most likely this would be the United Nations on health issues and global health issues. That's where, and on similar issues, where they really realized we are in fact one world, right? And our conflicts, you know, sort of pale in comparison to some of these major challenges humanity faces.
Great, so we have a question from the chat from Raymond Wong, who's one of our PhD students, but he's in a noisy environment right now, so I'm gonna read it for you. Under what conditions are non-superpower actors more likely to have agency during the Cold War? What distinguishes the cases where local actors manipulate the Cold War narrative from those where the opposite happens?
So more agency is, I think, when the superpowers do not have the instruments to really have and to understand what is actually going on the ground. And Vietnam is, for me, the really a good example. When they use the wrong instruments, Afghanistan is the other one. When they use military means where they should have probably used economic and political means. I have become, in the Vietnam issue, personally, I have become, you know, I was very critical. I was coming from the Cold War. I was not critical about the United States. I moved to the camp of critics. I now move back. I see South Vietnam as a non-communist nationalist expression of Vietnamese statehood, right? Economic, political means probably would have been more successful, but there is sort of a window of opportunity that closes. So that's one, actually, one answer. So superpowers are particularly successful when they use the right tools in each conflict, and that requires an awful lot of knowledge of what is going on the ground in an individual country. Now, when are agents particularly successful? you know, there's on the one hand, you know, when the superpower is on the other side of the conflict, you know, then they are particularly successful, and then they force the superpower actually to come to onto their level in fighting that conflict. But you have always, you know, the chance of a smaller power basically engaging with the superpower, you know, hegemon. East Germany is a particular good case. East Germany forcing actually the hand of Khrushchev to build, to basically build the wall, right? That's a stepwise project. And it's by stepwise, in very small steps, just creating facts on the ground and essentially, you know, eliminating policy alternatives of the superpower. And this is essentially where Khrushchev is in July 1961. There's no alternative to building actually, to giving the green light to building the Berlin Wall in August 1961. So it's the policy of small steps in that case that really leads to success. And the constant grinding on the superpower, right? To get the superpower where you want the superpower to be.
Great, so we'll have one more question before turning off the live stream. Tyler Bowen, do you wanna turn on your microphone? Over to you. Well, we can't hear you, Tyler.
Hear me now?
Yes.
Okay, good. Yeah, I really enjoyed listening to the talk. I like the thesis that, you know, you have to understand what happened in during the Cold War as like the agent, like the pawns on the, or the chess pieces themselves causing actions and doing their own making their own decisions, and then that then affects what the superpowers can do. I do want to push you to see what are the limits to that interpretation of events between 1945 and 1990. As in, are there certain events that just would not have happened without a Soviet American competition? And like, for instance, how do you explain something like the Vietnam War without the context of America's, you know, concern for its reputation for resolve and upholding alliance commitments to, you know, other allies in East Asia and Europe? Mm-hmm. So like, for instance, like, you know, the Vietnam War just, you know, it just wouldn't have happened. It just seems like it's something that just wouldn't have happened with, if you don't have the superpower competition. So it seems in some ways the superpower competition is making possible, you know, local, regional, certain local and regional events.
Let me first go to another conflict and I come back to the to Vietnam, Kashmir. Kashmir would have happened anyway. What the superpower does, it entrenches the conflict, but it doesn't cause the conflict. This is a decolonization conflict and one of nation formation and of competing nation formations. And it's just, you know, as Pakistan becomes the most allied of the United States, right? It really brings the Cold War to South Asia, and to a certain degree, you know, forces India in becoming more assertive. So that's an example. Vietnam, I have a chapter, this is chapter 6, if I remember correctly, and this is about Vietnam. And basically what I try to push my readers is, you know, forget about the United States in this conflict. United States comes really very late into this conflict. This is a conflict about nation formation and decolonization. And it really starts with France in the 1920s. And, you know, there's internal, you know, debates among various Vietnamese intellectuals. How is actually our country going to look like in once we are independent? Is this going to be Annam? Is this going to be something like Vietnam? Is it going to be Indochina? These are very, very intense debates in the 20s and 30s. They continue. The communists are not really central to these debates in the 30s. They become central to them after 1945. What you have, this is actually a civil war. This is about who actually gets in power and has the right to determine, you know, what kind of state is this going to be and how the state is going to look like. Even just how the borders are going to look like. This is up for grabs in 45, right? And it is an anti-colonial conflict that becomes a Cold War conflict, and it really, the Americans come in very late really by the late 50s, by starting to give economic aid and then military aid by the early 60s. So we have to move away from this American-centric perspective of the Vietnam War. This war would have happened anyway. It would have ended much earlier. American participation contributed, extended it. I think to a certain degree, American participation made the North Vietnamese regime more radical under Le Duan. But there would have been a Vietnam War anyway. The Americans just would have probably not participated in it. And it would have ended relatively quickly, probably by 67 or 68.
Great, thank you. And so now we're gonna turn off the live stream. Thanks to everyone who've tuned in.